Hello all, Charlotte Isivu here from Sublime Mercies, the blog, the YouTube, the me. I am here today to tell you how I, Charlotte Isivu, found this antique, real gold, real diamond brooch online for $5. $5. I thought you might be interested because perhaps you can make a similar find yourself if you're armed with some information. So, without further ado, I shall proceed. The first thing I wanted to do, though, is apologize for my yellow fingers. Beau gave me an early birthday present. I'm turning 50! But anyway, he gave me an early birthday present of a gold testing kit, and I've been playing with it, and it involves acid. And I learned the hard way, not having read the warning, that you really should wear gloves when you use it. This doesn't actually hurt, although it feels strange to the touch, but it can't be good for my skin. So that explains the yellow. Let's move on to how I found this. First of all, I gotta say, we're in a really crazy world situation right now. I am almost entirely self-isolating. I'm disabled. I'm ancient. I'm almost 50. I don't work because I'm disabled. Beau works from home. So we're able to stay home. We want to stay home. We want to stay safe. We want to keep other people safe. But I'm going a little squirrely watching world events and what's going on. And so I'm finding myself almost obsessed about making really great jewelry finds, which nowadays means doing it online. So that helps because I'm online a lot. It calms me down. I find it soothing. It's something pretty and relaxing and ultimately not that important, and that's kind of what I need. So part of how and why I found that is just because I needed a distraction. And my distraction was, what if I could find something real online being sold as fake? What if I could find online, because I can find this in person in thrift stores and stuff. I'm really good at finding things that people think aren't real that are real. But could I do it online? So my inspiration was, in fact, the post I made for you recently called Blue Moon, the YouTube video called Blue Moon, there's my yellow, about starting with this brooch, which is made around the same time as this, which I'm thinking is around 1910, something like 1910, 1900 to 1920, something like that. In that video, I told you that when I found this, it wasn't a pendant, it was a brooch. And I had it for years before I realized that on the clasp, which is no longer here, but on the clasp, it had a hallmark. The hallmark told me who had made it, and the hallmark often tells you if it's made of gold. In this case, that information is right here. It says 10 carat. I had not known that hallmarks were ever on brooch clasps. They're not anymore. And the reason why is because clasps are made differently nowadays. But around this time period, brooch clasps were what we call C-clasps. I've talked about those before with you. A C-clasp looks like, come on, focus on the right thing. There we go. This is a C-clasp. It's called a C-clasp because it looks like a C. So it's pretty straightforward. And they, unlike the clasps that we have nowadays, which we call rollover clasps. Can you see that? It's quite dark, isn't it? There we go. The clasps that you're used to seeing nowadays. A C-clasp has room for a hallmark on it. You can put a hallmark on it because there's room. So what I decided to do is look for bar pins, just do a search for bar pin on Etsy and see if I could find someone who hadn't noticed the hallmark on the C-clasp. I thought, if I hadn't noticed for God knows how many years on the piece that I had, there was every chance that other people haven't noticed those and maybe don't even know, even if they're a seller. So what I was basically looking for is what's known as fine jewelry, as in real gold, real gems. Well, actually, I was really just looking for real gold, but I lucked out. Being sold as costume jewelry, meaning fake. You know, the stuff that you can get for less money, new as well as vintage and antique. So that's what I did. I rather obsessively, but in fun way, started looking at bar pins. Bar pin is just exactly what you're seeing here. It's a bar and it's a pin. I'm going to keep it on the Q-tip for now, but it's a pin, meaning it's a brooch. Pin and brooch mean the same thing. And, you know, bar pins were very popular at the time that C-clasps were being used. They were all over the place. You saw them all the time. So I was looking around and I came across a seller who was selling, I don't know, about six pieces altogether for $40. And this was among them. She referred to this. She described this as gold tone, which is a jewelry seller's fancy way of saying fake gold. It's just, they're not trying to trick you. It's just, that's the way they say it. So there's gold tone and there's silver tone. Something like this is silver tone. And by the way, very modern, not antique, barely vintage. She advertised this as gold tone. So she thought it wasn't real. And she referred to the center stone as a rhinestone, which, as you probably know, means not a real gemstone, not a diamond. But she also mentioned that there was a hallmark on the back. She said there was a mark on the back on the clasp that she couldn't read. She couldn't see it. So, you know, me being me, I wrote to her and just sort of tried to sound really casual and said, oh, could I see the mark on the back? Could I get a better photo? And she sent me some extremely blurry, impossible to see photos. But what it did confirm to me is there's something on there and it very well may be a hallmark, and you don't see hallmarks on fake jewelry. You see maker's stamps, which is like brand name stamps, but you don't see hallmarks, which tell you things like 14 karat silver, the maker, yes, so that brand name, etc. So I thought, So I said ever so casually again, would you be willing to sell me the brooch on its own? And she said, sure. Does $5 sound okay? And I said, yeah, sure. Now, another reason why I was interested in this is because although it was extremely dirty, and I have some photos that I'll show you of how incredibly dirty it was when I got it, none of the dirt looked like what is called verdigris, I believe verdigris, I think that's the term. Verdigris is this, yuck, right here. Verdigris, I want to get it in the good light. Verdigris is kind of a greeny, bluish blech that forms on a metal that is not precious metal. It's not gold. It's not silver. It might be brass. It might be nickel. Look, just touching it, little black yicks fell off. And yes, I have cats. I apologize. Verdigris can ultimately eat up a piece, destroy a piece. So I seldom will buy anything with verdigris, which is why I really only have this one example of it. Bought these because they were very good price. This is an example of Murano glass, which I've talked about before with you. And I thought at this price, I'm going to buy them anyway. They're earrings. But they do have verdigris and dirt and all kinds of blit on them. So I didn't pay that much. I think they were $10. Anyway, that's an aside. So this, although it was very dirty, it didn't have any verdigris on it. And it didn't have any sort of tarnish or coming through or any chipping of any kind of sort of surface metal. This piece here, which is really beautiful, I had it converted into an earring. This is what is called a lingerie clip, and I'll talk about those another time. So this is circa 1900. This is probably rolled gold, so it's a really strong, really good gold plate, and it's very, very beautiful. But over, 120 years, it starts to lose the tarnish, lose the gold. The gold starts to come off, and it also starts to get verdigris. You can't see it here, but it's got some of the green verdigris. I saw none of that on here. I wasn't positive because it was so dirty. I thought maybe it was like this, but that was a good sign too. And there was no chipping. I think, let me see, does this have an example of chipping? Not really. What about this one? Yeah, I think in this one, especially on the stem here, you can see that the shiny surface is actually chipped off in places. And that's always a bad sign if you're hoping that it's real. Yeah, you can see it along the edges here as well. So there was no chipping as well. So that was also a good sign. So I was hoping. And for $5, who really cares? Although there was some shipping, but it worked out to like $10 total or something like that. So when it arrived, I was happy. and I didn't know what I was going to find. I opened it up and it was filthy. And I thought, oh, I guess it's just brass. It's probably not real. Because things that aren't real, they don't clean up that well. Like, I washed this and it didn't, none of this came off. So I thought, yeah, well, I don't know. Something I did notice though, and became curious about immediately, oops, I dropped my pointer, was this stone. I hadn't really given the stone much thought. I just thought, oh, it's real gold. Maybe it's real gold when I ordered it. But then when I looked at the stone, I thought, Mamma Mia, that's got quite the glitter. Let me see if I can get it closer. It's got light play. It's got color play. And I thought, good Lord, is that a real diamond? Is that a real diamond in brass? That's so strange. That doesn't seem right to me. The other things, though, that were right is it was definitely of the time period that I thought it was. It was, the style. Ooh, look at the light play when it's blurry. The style was spot on. The clasp is spot on. So, I mean, I wasn't concerned that the hinge is right for the time period. I knew it was the right time period. And so I did what any good jewelry collector does. I turned it over and I looked for the hallmark. And this is about what it looked like in the photos. But, well, look at that. Something. There was definitely, there we go, a hallmark. And it looked to me like it said 1KO, which seemed weird, because K is for carat, as in, the carats of gold. So I thought, well, that's weird. What is that? So I posted photos on a jewelry collectors group that I'm on Facebook. And very, very quickly, someone wrote back and said, that is the Cohn Company. K-O-H-N, and they were able to tell me right away that meant, yes, it is gold. It's 10 carat, 10K. And the Cohn Company was in operation from 1909 to 1931. And they made 10 carat and 14 carat jewelry. I was still, to be honest, a little skeptical because it was just so blech looking. But it did pass the magnet test. This is a magnet, and the magnet doesn't stick to it at all. But the magnet doesn't stick to other non-precious metals. This brooch from a little bit earlier, around the same time period. It also doesn't stick to. I tested it. It's nickel, which is not a precious metal. So I thought, I don't know. But then I washed it. Turning over my notes here. I washed it, and it cleaned up beautifully. I was really surprised because, as I said, things that aren't real gold that are this old do not clean up beautifully. Very quickly, most of the dirt came away, and if I were to wash it more carefully, I'm sure I could get rid of all of the dirt. Washing it, by the way, I just soaked it for a little while in gentle dish soap and water, and then I scrubbed it with a soft toothbrush, and then I rubbed it a bit with a polishing cloth. You can see around the clasp, I wasn't all that careful, but I mean, all the dirt, though, it was just gone, and suddenly it was gleaming like gold. I mean, I could see, okay, this is real gold. And so, of course, I looked again at the stone. I mean, that stone has a flash in it that you just do not find in rhinestones. And also, it's very hard to explain, but the softness around the corners here, the mellowness of the color, that all speaks to something being gold. Fake gold has a much harsher appearance. It's hard to explain, but you start to learn to get a sense of fake gold, and it just has a sharpness to it, a garishness to it that real gold doesn't have. So I'm looking at this stone, and these are some of the things I noticed about the stone. First of all, the color play, the light play on it, the really, really careful faceting. Fake doesn't do that at all. Look at the difference between these two. This is fake. This is also not antique, by the way. There's several things that tell me that. The textured back, the type of hinge, the rollover clasp. So this is not actually that old. It's meant to look old, but it's not actually that old. So anyway, and also you can see the chipping on here, the colors chipping off. These are all signs that this is not real. Even an old piece might look the same, but this one is not that old. Anyway, these are rhinestones. They are much newer than this, and yet look at the difference. This is yellowed, it's milky, it's not clear, it has nowhere near as many facets on it. And look at the setting at the back. See if I can undo this for you. In the front, it's really not very carefully set. It's made to look like it's got prongs around it in here to hold it steady, but they're not. It's really just kind of glued in there. You can see they're not very carefully lined up in here. And then if you look at the back, there's no light coming in the back. It's not set up so that light can pass through it. Compare that to this. First of all, in the front, you can see that it's very carefully set. You can see that, they've put a lot of careful energy into setting this so that it's not going to come loose. And then you look at the back, and hang on. They've set it up so that light can come through. And that is lots of rhinestones are set this way too, but that's a good start. You're not gonna put a solid backing on a gemstone because you want the light to be able to shine through. Very, very old pieces, yes, they have what's called a foiled backing. We'll talk about that another time. But this isn't old enough for them to have done that. So, for this to be open in the back is also a really good sign. And again, look at how carefully they've set it. They've given it its own little, I guess you might call this a rivet to sit in. This setting is a very very common one. It's a really practical one. You don't tend to lose the diamond. You don't tend to catch it on anything. It's known as a bezel setting. I wanted to show you something, to show you what a bezel setting looks like, a larger one. This is my husband's engagement ring and his wedding ring. He had them welded together so that they wouldn't stick on things. But yes, I gave my husband an engagement ring because I'm a modern gal. This is a bezel setting. You can see it's actually quite similar. This is obviously much tinier. This is a sapphire. And if you look at the back, you see how it's very similar in the back? It's designed to let light through, because why wouldn't you want light to come through a real gem? So this is a bezel setting. Obviously, this is modern, this is real. This is also a bezel setting. This is real diamonds. This is a beautiful piece I bought for myself many years ago at Burke's Jewelers. So this is bezel setting as well. The nice thing is it doesn't catch on anything. It's very practical. See how the light, if you blur it, you can see all the rainbow play in diamonds that you'll never see in a rhinestone. So again, lets the light through. So I was pretty sure I had a diamond, and I thought, oh my God, this is so exciting. My first diamond find. I'm so happy about this. But I had to be sure, and I don't have all the equipment set up for testing these things at home. So, before I got really excited, I took it to, I wanted to take it to a jeweler, like a reputable jeweler, but, it's COVID time and they just weren't able to do it for me. They recommended, some people recommended that I go to a pawn shop, but I don't really trust them. Nah, a lot of them are, kind of slimy. So I went, my jeweler recommended, like a gold trading place, you take your gold there, they pay you, they look at how much gold costs that day on the market, and they'll pay you by the weight. So they would weigh this and just say, okay, this is worth how much money, just the gold on its own. We'll melt it down and make something else. So anyway, I took it to them, and within about 3 seconds they tested it. They said, yep, it's a diamond. Yep, it's gold. And I was like, yeah, I already knew that, but okay, so it's gold. So then I brought it home, and now that I knew that it was a diamond, I suspected that it was probably an old setting, probably what's known as old European cut. Modern diamonds are what we call brilliant cut. It's a more modern technique that they just didn't have the technology to make. I don't know if you can tell, but they're cut, they're faceted differently. So I wanted to see, is this an old European cut? Because, okay, let's be honest, a diamond this tiny is not actually worth that much on its own. For example, on this, this, which I had made, I decided to add what's called an accent diamond, a very small diamond at the top, and it really didn't cost me very much. Now, this one's a little smaller than that one. Accent diamonds can be even tinier. I don't know if you can see. I have accent diamonds in all of the leaves here, and they're teensy weensy, but they just sort of catch the light really nicely. Yeah, I designed this, and I also designed Beau's pieces, and I've designed a couple other pieces. It's really fun, but oh my God, not cheap, so you can only do it occasionally. Like really, really, really occasionally. Anyway, so this isn't much bigger than an accent diamond, but I did think that it was an old European diamond, which would make it a little bit more collectible. People are looking for those nowadays. They want to have a new piece that has an old look. So if they're designing a piece that they want to make look old, they're going to look for diamonds that are cut in older styles, or several older styles. So I went online and I did a little bit of research, and I thought, yeah, okay, this is what you call an old European cut. The main thing, if I look at it, I can sort of see that it has kind of uneven faceting on it. Let's see, can I get that to focus? No. still know. Okay, trust me. The faceting is somewhat uneven on here. Whereas, you know, with things done with lasers, the faceting is, you know, each facet is really carefully identical to all the others. So I saw that. And then with my loop, I've talked to you about loops before. You really, really want to own one. It's a method of magnifying a piece so you can see it even better. Look, you can actually see what I'm talking about here. So I got out my loop and I looked at it from the front and the back. And oh my goodness, you can actually see. Can you see? At the center of this diamond, there's like a little white circle. I think you can see that there. Yes, you definitely can see it. That little white circle is known as a coulet. I believe it's coulet, C-U-L-E-T. And it's a marker of an older cut of diamond. They just didn't have the technology to make the point a completely precise point. It was a little bit cut off at the bottom. You can see it from front and back with this one. Fidget. There we go. You can see it even here. You can see the little white circle again, right? Old European cut. I don't think it's much older than that. Old mine cut would be even older. I'm not very good at differentiating them, but anyway. So you can see right there, whereas if you look at this piece, which is modern, there's just no circle there. Let me see if I can even magnify it for you. You see what I mean? There's no circle at the very bottom, at the deep end of it. It's a perfect point, or almost a perfect point at any rate. And if you look at the back, you'll see the same thing. There's just not that same circle. It's a perfect point, which is beautiful and lovely and shinier and glitterier than these, but that just shows you that it's modern. So I had the real deal. Excuse me, I'm all excited here. I love diamonds. And I had the real deal for $5 friggin' dollars. So that's my tale, and I'm very proud of it. The big question now, of course, is how am I going to wear it? As usual, I don't know why I've been stuck so long in the past in my posts to you and my YouTube videos for you. But again, this is a little tiny piece that a woman would have worn at her throat on a very high-necked collar, and we don't wear those anymore. I've tried to pair it with a couple of outfits, to greater or lesser success. Not that I'm going out much, and when I go out I don't really go anywhere. I just wheel around in my mobility scooter in the neighborhood and maybe get really brave and go to a cafe, but to me that's an excuse to dress up. So I've tried to wear this. I find it's actually surprisingly heavy on modern fabric, and so it sort of tips sideways like this and you can't really see it. Tried to wear it as a necklace, it just tipped. I think I'm going to do something with this one that I kind of said I would never do because it's really trendy right now, but I think it'd be very pretty. So rather than do what I did with this bar pin, which is from about the same time period and it's also gold, rather than turn it into a pendant that hangs perpendicular, is that the word? This way, mm-hmm. on your chest, I thought I might make it as one that hangs this way. It's extremely trendy right now, though. So trendy it annoys the heck out of me. You'll see a lot of these old bar pins converted into horizontal pendants that have a dedicated chain, meaning you can only wear one. They come with the chain, and you can't interchange the chain with any other chain. But I think this one would look really nice that way. However, I think what I'm going to do, and I'm going to have to ask a jeweler if this is even possible, but what I would love to do is put on either end two tiny clasps similar to this kind here. I know it'll look a bit weird, but if I had one on this side and one on this side, then I could hook it up to a necklace and wear it like this. So clasps on here, hook it up to a necklace and wear it like this. Or I could turn it around and wear it like this. And I could also wear it on any chain I wanted to, so that I could wear it at a lot of different lengths. So I'm going to see if I can do that. These horizontal pins were also really popular in the 70s, so I figure I might go for another disco-licious 70s kind of look with this. You can find a lot of costume ones of that style from, you know, circa 1980, 1979, 1981, that kind of thing, sort of disco. So that's kind of the style I'm going for. Let me know what you think. I am very proud. This is my very first diamond score. So it's exciting. It's fun. Honestly, this pin, if I were to resell it, it'd be somewhere between $300 and $500, I'm guessing. So it's not like, I mean, that's valuable, of course, and it's a great markup from $5. But it's not really about that. It's just about the fun of it. It's about feeling smart. It's about the sleuth work. And it's also, first and foremost, it's about the beauty. And the history. An old piece has history. And this is my old piece, one of many. All right, I hope you enjoyed that. Bye-bye.